I want to show you how to create parent constraint and how to plan the method to use based on the type of action you have. There's a lot of different ways to constrain an object to another, and I will show you some of the more common situations using the Maya constraint. What is a constraint? It's basically a relationship between two or more objects. One is the target object, the one that leads the movement or the position, and the other is the constraint object that is influenced by the target, so it doesn't move independently, but it's driven by the target object. The type of constraint depends on the axis you need to constrain to the lead object, translation, rotation, or scale. In Maya, if you go in the animation tab and then on constraint, you find some different type of constraint: point, aim, orient, scale, and parent. The more used are point, orient, and parent constraint. As I said before, the difference between these constraints are the axis involved. The point constraint influences the translation axis, orient constraint influences the rotation axis, and the parent constraint both translation and rotation. When you open the constraint option panel, you will have the first box, maintain offset. That means that if you turn it on, the object will be constrained to maintain his starting position. If you turn it off, when you will apply the constraint, it will jump on the target pivot. In most of the cases, you will need to turn it on, so always check the maintain offset before applying the constraint. Another thing you can check is the constraint axis. Here you can choose which axis you want to constrain. Here we have the translation and rotation because it's parent constraint. By default, you have all the axes turning on, but you can turn it off the ones you don't need. When you apply the constraint, you will see that the axis constraint turned blue in the channel box. Let's now see the different situations where you will need to constrain some objects. These are the different situations we will go to analyze. Constrain hands on body parts. An object grabbed with an hand. Constrain a character or parts of it to an object. An object capped with both the hands. And an object passed from an hand to another. Before you start the animation and create the constraints, you have to plan the shot. Do it in your mind or with some sketches, because it's important to decide how to do the constraint and you need to anticipate all the actions you will do with the constraint objects. Let's start with the first situation, hands on body parts. In this simple animation, the character keeps his hands on his hip, so we need to constrain the hands to the hip in order to follow the hip movement. In some rigs, you could have the possibility to choose if the hands must follow the hip or other parts of the body without manually creating a constraint, but in case you have a basic rig without this option, let's see how to manage it. So the hip will be the lead object that will drive the hands. This must be in IK mode. So switch both the hands in IK, put them on the hip, and remember that to apply the constraint, you always have to select the target control first, the one that will lead the movement, so in this case the hip, and then the control or object you want to constrain. So in this case, select the hip control, then shift and select the control of one of the hands. Go in the animation tab, constrain, and choose parent. We choose parent because we want that the hands follow the hip in both translation and rotation axis. So open the option, be sure to have the maintain offset turned on, and apply it. So the translation and rotation turn blue in the channel box. So now this hand is constrained to the hip. Let's do the same with the other one. At one point, he detached the hands from the hip, so we need to turn off the constraints in order to animate the hands independently. So we simply select the hands control one at a time and we set a key. When you do this, in the channel box, you can see that the constrained axis turned green and you have a new attribute, the parent attribute that you can animate. So on the last keyframe, where you still need a constraint, set this attribute at 1 and add a key. In the following frame, set it at 0 and add another key. So from this point, you can animate the hands. Another simple example is a character that puts his hand on the shoulder of another character. In this case, you do the same. You constrain the hands on the shoulder control, and then you animate the parent attribute before you touch him, turning the constraint off and turning on when he touches the shoulder. In this way, if you animate the other character, the hand follows the second character's movements. Or two characters holding the hands, first pose their two hands, then choose the lead hand and constrain the other to this one. Another situation, an object grabbed with an hand, like this ball. He takes it with an hand. In this case, you can use IK or FK for the hands, it doesn't matter. And then he throws it. So the ball will be driven by the character, but at one point it will move independently. In this simple example, you could just constrain the ball geometry. It's not necessary to have a locator or a rig for the ball because the animation is pretty easy. But if you have to do more complex actions with the ball, I suggest you to use a locator or a rigged ball so that you could also have a squash stretch. So in this example, I just constrained the geometry to the hand as I showed in the previous example. Pose the ball in the starting pose, then pose the hand at the point where he grabbed it. Select the hand control, shift and select the ball geometry and choose parent constraint. add a key and set at 1 the parent attribute. In the previous frame, set it at 0, so the ball stays in the starting position. And when you need to detach the ball from the hand, animate again the parent attribute so that you can turn off the constraint and animate the ball. Or to have more control and have the possibility to add secondary movements on the ball, you can open the outliner, select the ball geometry and press G. So you go to create a group and you go to constraint this group to the hand so that you can still animate the ball geometry in case you will need to add further movements. Another example, let's change the type of prop. Let's say he grab a bottle. If you create a group for the bottle geometry and you go to constrain the group to the hand, you can still select the bottle geometry to add some overlap. I just moved the pivot on the top so that the ball start to rotate from this point. To edit the pivot position, you just select the mesh and pressing D, you move it where you want. So now the bottle is driven by the hand because the bottle group is constrained, but we can animate the geometry to add this overlap. Third situation, constrain a character or parts of it to an object. There are some situations where you will need to constrain the character. For example, a character on a swing. Of course, this is not a common thing so you will have to animate, but it's just to give you an example of a situation where your character is driven by something. You pose the character on the seat, the hands are in IK, the legs must be in FK. You constrain the cog of the character to the seat so that when you move the swing, the body follows the movements, except for the hands that are in IK. So to constrain the hands to the swing's ropes, we need to create two locators. So we go to create locator and we turn on the locator's visibility from the show panel and we move it on the first rope where you have the hand and Ctrl D to duplicate this locator and move the second one on the other side. Then select one rope, shift the first locator and parent constraint. Do the same for the other locator, or you can avoid to create a constraint, but you can just parent the locators to the rope. Let's quickly see the difference between parent constraint and parent. The parent constraint is what we have seen so far, a relationship between two or more objects that you can control, and it can be turned off and on depending on your needs and can be applied on some axes that you can choose between translation, rotation and scale. Parent is a permanent relationship between a parent and the child that doesn't change. The child is subordinate to the parent, no matter what, but you can still animate it independently. But anytime you translate, scale, or rotate the parent, the child will follow. So now the two locators follow the swing. So now we select one locator and the hand control, and we create the parent constraint. And we do the same for the other locator. So now the character is attached to the rope with hands, and the body follows the swing movements. Or another situation, a character trying to lift an heavy object without success, it would be easier for you to constrain the hands on the object, so you create two locators. Then, selecting the two locators, we create a group, pressing G, and we constrain this group to the object. So we select the object and then the locators group, and we go to constraint, parent, so now the locators group is constrained to the object. Now we want to position the locators where we have the hands. To quickly do that, we create a temporary constraint. We go on the frame where the hands touch the object, we select the hand control, then one of the locator, and we uncheck the maintain offset. So the locator jumps on the wrist pivot, let's delay to the constraint, and then we constrain the head control to the locator. So select the locator and then the wrist control and create another parent constraint. From this point you can forget the hand control and use the locator to animate the hand. Do the same for the other locator to pose it on the wrist pivot and then constrain the hand to the locator. In this way, when you animate the object that leads the movement, the hands follow, but you can also add some further movements for the hands by using the locators that are free to move, because we just constrained the group of the locators. Let's see another situation, a character holding an object with both the hands. This is also something very common, and I'm going to show you two different options for this. The first and faster way is to pose both the hands on the object, constrain the object to one of the hand, the one you choose as the leading hand, the one that controls the movement, and constrain the other hand to the object. But if you want something more complex, for example, if you want to change the position of the hands while grabbing the object, you have to do what we have done in the example of the EV object, creating two locators, parent the object to one of these locators, so let's press P, and parent the second locator to the object. Selecting the parent locator, we move the object in position. We constrain the parent locator to the lead hand control. The lead hand can be in FK or IK, but the other hand that will be constrained to the object must be in IK. So we select the lead control, then the parent locator, and we create a parent constraint, maintaining the offset. Then we select the other hand control, then the second locator, and we create a parent constraint, this time deselecting the maintain offset. So the locator moves on the wrist pivot, that's the late disc constraint, and we select again the locator, then the left hand control, and we do parent constraint again. So now you can use the right arm to lead the movement, the object and the left arm follow, but using the left locator you can add further movements for the left hand and change position during the animation. A character passing an object from an end to another. In this case, when you plan to grab the same object with both the hands in different time, it means that the object must be constrained to one hand first and then on the other hand in a second time. To do that, first let's set up the two locators on the object. So we create two locators that we rename left and right hand. Then we need to parent the two locators and the object. At this point, we should plan which hand holds the object first. So based on that, we create this parent hierarchy. First, we select the locator of the second hand that will hold the object in the second time. Then we select the locator of the first hand and we press P. So now in the outliner, you can see that the left hand locator is child of the locator of the right hand. Now let's select the object and the left hand locator and we press P. And now the object is child of the left hand locator. So if we move the right hand locator, we move everything. But if we select the left hand locator, we move just the object. And the locator of the right hand stays in position. So now selecting the parent locator, in this case the right hand locator, we position it in the right hand. And then we constrain it to the right hand control. So we select the hand control, shift the locator, and we create a parent constraint, maintaining the offset. Now we can move the hands and the object follows. When we want to switch the hand, we just have to move on the frame where the object is grabbed by the left hand. Then we select the left hand control, shift the left hand locator, and we create the parent constraint again. We go to add the key, and we set at 1 the constraint on this frame, but we set it at 0 in the previous frame. Sometimes it happens that, for different reasons, that you don't see the parent attribute in the channel box. If this happens, you can just select the constraint node from the outliner and set it at 1 or 0, the weight value, so that you can manage the influence of the constraint on the locator. So now the object is constrained to both the hands in different times. A similar situation is when the character passed an object, like a hat, from an end to another and then it put it on the head. In this case, the process is the same, but we need to add a third locator, that is the one that will be constrained to the head. So we start setting the locators on the head, we create three locators that we rename as the body parts they will be constrained to, and we go to parent the locators. So first we select the right hand locator, then the left hand locator, and we press P. Then the head locator and the right hand locator and we press P. And last, we select the head geometry, then the head locator and we press P. So now selecting the parent locator, we position the head in the left hand, that is the first one that holds the head, and we constrain it to the hand control. Then we do as in the previous example, we animate the constraints attribute on and off. When we switch the hands, we constrain the right hand to the other locator and the same when the head is on the head. So that in the final part, the head is just constrained to the head and follows the head movements. These are just some examples of how to manage constraints on Maya. There are a lot of different ways to do them. It really depends on what you need in your scene, and it also changes depending on the type of rig you have. There are also scripts and tools to automatically create constraints, especially in production. But if you are beginners, this should be enough to start to manage props in your animation. In general, when you want to delete a constraint, you can select the constraint control or group or mesh and in the channel box, select all the attributes constraint, right-click, break connections. Or you can select the object, press F in the outliner and delete the constraint parent node. Or if you want to delete the constraint but you want to keep the animation, you can bake the curve, selecting the object and in the graph editor, click in curves, bake channel. So it will convert the entire animation in keyframes. And now you can delay the constraint as I showed before, without losing the animation. In the last lesson, I explained the principle of secondary actions, and props are a good way to add these actions. So now you know how to manage the constraint, and you can create animations with secondary actions, follow the exercise you can find in the blog, and put in practice this principle.